I am Rachel Rosenthal. About a month or so ago, a strange and unexpected thing happened to me. I have trouble talking about it because it caused me great stress and anxiety. I was going through a bad period, unable to work, depressed, angry and resentful toward many, and negative about myself, dumping on myself a lot. I was scheduled to perform on February 21st, and the more I tried to prepare, the more I wanted to vomit. A change was taking place, a passage, a difficult pass. I looked back on my life, wanting to draw from it as I did in the past for my performances, but I could find nothing in the 5 decades of my existence to be proud of. I saw mismanagement, promise unfulfilled, opportunities ignored. I saw things to be ashamed of, and worst of all, I saw the beast in the jungle. The beast in question was a short story by Henry James that had scared the daylights out of me when I was in my teens. It was a story of a man who spends his life believing that he is singled out for a unique destiny, something totally extraordinary that will pounce on him someday like a beast in a jungle. The man wastes his life waiting, and realizes too late that what he had expected all these years had indeed happened to him, and that he was to be the one man on earth to whom nothing was to happen. Dreading this would be my case too, I spent my life in action, going from thing to thing, always afraid that nothing would happen and that the beast would pounce. In my depression, I strongly suspected it had, and experienced a true failure of nerve and bankruptcy of spirit. I felt defeated, damaged, and unable to move. I put on 30 pounds. In order to get myself out of that place, I decided on the most extreme shock therapy. So I went up by myself for a week to Grand Canyon. I must tell you that somewhere in my 4th or 5th decade, I developed a mild but annoying case of acrophobia. Whenever I find myself on a high balcony, ants crawl up my legs and I'm invited to climb over the railing by the beckoning void. I had seen enough photos and films of Grand Canyon to know that it would be rather a strain for an acrophobic. But I rented my ski clothes, got a AAA triptych, and drove up. I arrived at night, slowly climbing up the gently sloping Coconino Plateau, 6,500 feet up between the snow-laden pinyon pines, fantasizing that I'd miss seeing the rim in the dark and go sailing over the edge in my Mazda wagon. I was relieved when I arrived at the civilized canyon village and asked for a cabin at the lodge. As the clerk gave me my keys, I casually asked where the canyon was, and he, just as casually, nodded his head in the direction of the back door. "Right there," he said. I struggled to look unperturbed. I stepped gingerly out the door onto the icy snow and saw nothing. An immense, black, gaping silence caught me by the throat. I was deeply excited, yet filled with an undefinable malaise. I noted that the comforting stone parapet did not extend beyond a couple hundred yards, and I beat a hasty retreat to my cabin. Next morning, I woke up at 6 and walked outside. With all that I had known about that thing, the photographs, the books, the movies, nothing had prepared me for what I saw. This monstrous wound, this pink and red exposed earth flesh, this cosmic vagina of our planet, so utterly beyond our comprehension of space, of scale, of time. I walked the rim for miles, learning to recognize the Temple of Osiris, the Throne of Wotan, the Pyramid of Cheops, through their endless disguises of fog, shadow carvings, snow flurries, and violet dusk. I stumbled on between terror and intoxication, forcing myself to look down sheer drops of 2,000 feet until I felt as though I were buried up to my neck in an anthill. I dreamed of that hole at night and felt its fearful proximity like a constant siren song. My body began to ache, yet my diaphragm was throbbing with excitement. After a couple of days, I woke up one morning during one of the snowstorms and felt an unaccustomed peace come over me. My body felt at home. I was alert. My misery still there, but how can I put it? It felt alive instead of lying inert and dry around my middle. I went to brush my teeth, and in the mirror I seemed different. My eyes were brighter. The dead look was gone. I seemed to glow. I opened my mouth to insert the brush, and then I noticed something. It was subtle. You could have thought they were my natural canines, just slightly longer. No big deal. Before I could take full stock of the situation, I felt a spasm of fear contracting my back muscles. And in the mirror, as I gazed in a mixture of wonder and horror, I saw two giant black wings, featherless, their sleek membranes still damp and wrinkled between the curved ribs, awkwardly unfurling and stretching behind me in the half-darkness of the unlit bathroom. I stood like this a long time, my canines quite visible now as my mouth gaped open, watching the involuntary shudders agitating my bat wings in direct response to my inner trepidation, like the lashing about of a cat's tail. Why was this happening to me? How did it happen? I couldn't think of anything that could predestine me to this. I hadn't eaten red meat in years, was not particularly a night person, hated blood, and was fat. I had never heard of a fat vampire. However, I was amazed to feel no great despair, and even, and that was quite strange, a certain quietude, as though some very exhausted thing had finally come to rest. And then I knew, with no sudden shock, but as though the knowledge had been there all along, why I came to Grand Canyon, and what I had to do there. I had to fly the great chasm. I reached in back of me. My wings seemed fragile, but they were so huge that I couldn't stretch them out fully in the small cabin. And there would be little chance to practice, because although there were relatively few people at the canyon in winter, there were still enough for me to cause a nasty scene if I was spotted by someone flapping my giant wings in the back of the parking lot or around the mules' compound. I folded them neatly under my parka, reminded myself to smile with my lips closed, and went out for breakfast. I began planning my flight. I bought some pamphlets and books and some maps. I figured I'd do it at sundown and hoped I wouldn't attract any attention. I knew that I would have to let myself fall from one of the highest and steepest of the viewpoints, one without a railing so I could take a running leap into the void. The thought of it sickened me at first. But then it snowed, and the canyon was completely hidden from view for 2 days. I had only 1 day left, and I was half hoping it would keep snowing and prevent me from flying, and half praying the weather would lift so that I could accomplish my task. On the morning of the last day, I awoke to a pretty pink and blue canyon, its myriad nipples blushing in the rising sun. There was no turning back. I tried not to think and spent the day looking for coyotes, mule deer, and Abert squirrels. I spotted a flock of turkey vultures and many large ravens dropping and gliding down and out of sight. I studied their flight, although my wings were nothing like theirs. I hadn't been able to practice at all, and I tried not to worry about that. I was ready to die if I had to, in my maiden voyage, so I was beyond fear and fretting. The day passed, and I waited for dusk. When it came, with its mauve seductions and treacherous winds, I was ready, at Pima Point, jutting out over the abyss, a sheer drop of 3,300 feet. I climbed over the thin railing and looked down. The bottom was already floating in a deep violet haze. I held on to the railing with one hand, unbuttoning my parka with the other. I looked up. The sky was pure gold. I thought, Carlos did it, I'm not the first. But Carlos wasn't sure he did it after all. However, I had an advantage. I had wings. Large, pointed, elegant vampire wings. And I had no choice. I don't remember jumping or falling. Suddenly my eyes filled with tears as a gust of cold air whipped my lids. I was passing the white Kaibab limestone and the ochre toraweep at vertiginous speed. I almost hit the Coconino sandstone when I remembered to tighten my wing membranes and spread the ribs in a semicircle. I caught an air current sharply and veered away from the protruding hermit shale. The whistling in my ears subsided, and I was able to negotiate a smooth turn around the supai formation of Cope Butte down toward the gorge. The river was silver and gold inside the indigo gash. The sky darkened, and I panicked that night would overtake me. I let out a plaintive cry, and, to my surprise, it bounced off the red wall limestone and came back to me. I uttered another, closer to the wall, and my cry returned faster. I was ready for darkness. I realized I was coming dangerously close to the tapete sandstone of the Tonto platform and could make out its speckled dots of cacti in increasing detail. I remembered that I had only glided so far and tried to flap my wings. It was a tremendous effort of muscles heretofore unused and that I didn't even know I had. The wings were heavy and the air seemed dense as glycerin. My flapping was uneven and I banked. I almost scraped a wingtip on the bright angel shale, but I squeezed out my energy through my spine and into the rhythmic beat of my wings and experienced the ineffable power and the ecstasy of flight. I then started my voyage in earnest, using my radar at regular intervals, smoothly stroking the air for speed and elevation, and then catching a current and following it effortlessly like a kite on an invisible string for miles. When the flying became second nature, I began to look around. I noticed that I saw things in a different light, and suddenly realized that night had fallen and that I was able to see in the dark. The river sent back a purring sound on my radar. Intermittently, the rapids boiled, throwing off silver sparks in the dense black of the river funnel, its venerable Brahma schist walls gleaming like satin damask. As I traveled up, down, and across these rock annals of the earth, I began to discern certain patterns that seemed familiar, but that I still had trouble decoding. I saw the horizontal strata building every temple, every throne and butte with the same repertoire of materials and in the same order. Vishnu, tapetes, bright angel, muav, red wall, supai, each band with its characteristic color, texture, and property. I saw the inexorable sawing action of the river, slicing ever deeper into the Precambrian schist and the Zoroaster granite. I followed the gigantic unconformity, the fractured faults and flexed monoclines. I peeked into the caves and caverns and splashed under the falls. And suddenly, I saw the Grand Canyon for what it really was, a topographical map of my life. The soft Grand Canyon series, crumbly and self-indulgent, sheltering protectively my bucking river in its infancy, already programmed higher upstream by the Glen Canyon dam of my heredity, the gradual corseting and squeezing of my river by the looming walls growing taller and more strict, the insulation of my flow feeding voraciously from its nurturing tributaries and breaking out now and then into incorrigible and irrepressible rapids. I followed and recognized my faults. Bright angel, ah, the golden girl. Phantom, I wasn't there. Crystal, was I that attached? Cremation, oh, mother. All significant dislocations in my life, points of opportunities missed, or structured discordance between rock bodies that indicates interruption of the rock-forming process. World War II was one of them. and all the gorgeous structures, sculptured palaces, amphitheaters, and shrines became epochs, events in my life, monuments of solid time, fossilized by memory, whose outer contours were shaped by the erosion of my lifetime, yet whose building blocks are all exasperatingly the same. Toward the east, a large plateau of petrified waves and eddies stretched for mile years, my middle years of stagnation, my most fertile years, activated from below by secret gorges and erecting few but impressive temples of growth upon its monotonous surface. And then I saw it. The deepest, darkest, most threatening gash, dark and secret, beckoning, attracting me to plunge down into its bowels. I circled a few times, resisting, but when I looked back, the moon shone exactly above that deep cut, and I pitched forward and dove down. I felt the walls engulf me, and I hovered slightly above the river, the white circle of moon undulating gently on the black waters. I noted that the river flow was blocked, hampered by some obstruction. I lowered myself to look, and observed something floating in the water. For some reason, I was possessed with a frantic urge to flee. I tried to push the air down vigorously with my wings, but a pocket of static air held me down. I hovered for a while, caught between my efforts to escape and the pull of the gorge. I looked again, and there it was. At first I thought it was my own reflection, so precisely did it mirror my own shape. But it wasn't a reflection. It was a vampire, just like myself, dead, floating face up, its empty eyes staring up at me, its sharp canines protruding slightly between the retracted lips, its huge wings wedged between two rocks jamming the river. The body bobbed up and down, stuck, and exhibiting the ridiculous motions of a failed mechanism. I looked closer and thought I knew the face. It looked like my mother. The shock of this discovery sent me yawing across the gorge. I felt dizzy and disoriented, also vaguely nauseous. Weakly flapping my wings, I circled back, past the humid rock wall, and confronted the thing in the river. Was it really Mother? The resemblance was there, but I couldn't be sure. The eyes were blue, like mine, and the brow had my wrinkles. I became confused. I felt pity and horror at the same time. I alighted on one of the rocks and pulled the body up. It was very heavy and waterlogged, but I managed to drag and carry it to a ledge. It had the consistency of dream figures that one cannot pinpoint. It was not to be identified, yet seemed completely a part of me. I crouched down and looked at it for a long time as the grateful river below me resumed her interrupted flow. Still, I felt unfinished, inadequate. There was something to be done. On a small embankment, I saw some timber splinters, probably from the wreckage of a rowboat. I took one of them and drove it through the dead vampire's heart. I think I sat there on the damp ledge, weeping over the pierced body for many hours. I was cold but couldn't move. Finally, my body seemed to wake up. Whatever it was had been completed. Without looking back, I flew out of the gorge with even, powerful strokes. I found myself in a verdant oasis, Havasu Canyon, and I brushed past the emerald fern beds cushioning the falls. The vision of my self-portrait began to fade with the whitening of the sky. I felt my life, past, present, and future, defusing its potential to do me violence as it became diffused over the landscape. My night seeing gave way to normal daylight sight, and I felt the warmth of the sun's rays going through the membranes of my wings. I made it back to the cabin without being seen. A coyote howled, and a flock of white-throated swifts spiraled around the roof and flew off toward the sun. I was hungry, I noticed my wings began atrophying and shriveling almost immediately, and by noon only a slight protuberance remained at the shoulder blades. But the teeth remained. I would have a lot of work still to do before they could entirely disappear. But I knew at last who I was.